Good evening. India has always had to navigate a very complex neighborhood. But rarely before in time has our country had to face so many simultaneous global headwinds. From the Taliban takeover of Afghanistan to the PLA's military buildup along the line of actual control, the geostrategic risks to India are clear and present. The man responsible for charting the course of India's foreign affairs through these turbulent waters is a longtime practitioner in the fine art of diplomacy, considered by many in the foreign services as the finest of his generation. Dr. Jaishankar now has that rare opportunity to shape policy in his area of professional expertise. It's that sweet spot that lakhs of professionals dream about, but only the chosen few get to practice. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming, for his conclave debut in New Delhi, the External Affairs Minister of India, Dr. Subramaniam Jaishankar. Can we have a warm round of applause, please? Joining me for this interaction are India Today's Foreign Affairs Editor, Geeta Mohan, and Executive Editor of India Today Television, Shiva Rool. Dr. Jaishankar, welcome. Let me start by asking you about your reading of the current situation in Afghanistan. There have been lots of reports about the Baradar faction and the Haqqani faction being at loggerheads. How are you working towards recalibrating India's relationship with the new Afghanistan in light of the reality of the Taliban takeover in Kabul? Dr. Jaishankar.
Yes. First of all, thank you, Rahul. It's good to be with all of you today. Look, the situation in Afghanistan is still unfolding. There is still a lot of lack of clarity. I mean, obviously, some of the more visible changes are apparent. So you have to take your positions, make your decisions on the basis of what you have. Now, the general sense in the international community is that there are some basic expectations which the world has of Afghanistan. The most basic of them is actually the fact that Afghan soil will not be used for terrorism against other countries. There are also expectations about the nature of the government, that it would be inclusive in some form, there's a view about what are considered governance standards in this day and age. Question of how you deal with minorities, with women, with children, how you deal with people who want to leave your, go out of your country or come into your country, I mean, legitimate movement. So I think these are all live issues, and we are obviously quite involved in shaping the thinking of the international community on that, partly because we also happen to be at this time a UN Security Council member. Many of these debates are taking place there. Some of them are taking place in the G20 format. We had a foreign ministers meeting of the G20. So I think it's evolving. We are making it up, obviously responding to the situation as you go along. But beyond that, it's hard to take a very definitive position because the situation on the ground doesn't allow for it.
Just a question on the engagement. We know that when the Taliban took over Kabul, there was the first engagement between our ambassador in Doha, Deepak Mittal, and Stanak Zai. And since then, we've not really seen real engagement. So are we going to adopt a wait-and-watch policy? Because it seems like the Haqqanis have set the tone and tenor when it comes to ties with India, with the Indian administration. Anas Haqqani's tweet, in many ways than one, really sets the tone over there when he speaks of Somnath Temple taking pride in smashing the idol of Somnath.
Look, we are in different businesses, okay? You are in the news business, I'm in the diplomacy business. By nature, I would be more empirical, would be more I'd be more careful about my judgment. I mean, it's the nature of our business, okay, as opposed to yours. I am not sure I would completely agree with some of the things you say. You know, if this person has taken charge, and I mean, fine. I mean, people may take positions, people may tweet. We can speculate. That is our right. I think when it comes to policy making, I would do kind of double, triple, quadruple diligence, be very, very deliberative about my judgments. I have, you know, there's no great compulsion on me to take very sharp, definitive positions and be public about it, you know. So there could be things happening which, you know, I may not be able to speak about, but at the moment, as I said, as you said, actually, our primary contact has been in Doha, and that's where it is.
Mr. Jaishankar, from the Haqqanis that Geeta was talking about, I'd like to draw your attention now to Pakistan. With everything that's happened in Afghanistan, and like you said, many things are still in movement and in flux right now, how much more complicated has it made our navigation of the situation with Pakistan? Because the perception is that the ISI has won with everything that's happened in Pakistan, and therefore the simplistic way it's been looked at is that this has been a strategic setback for India. Vis-a-vis Pakistan, how are you navigating that?
I would take the same situation and say I have to operate out of a given, a set of assumptions. I can't say I wish it hadn't been like this, or the Americans had stayed on, or they'd have gone out a different way. They've done what they've done. I have to live with it and deal with it accordingly. If you ask me, say October 8th, is my security situation more complicated than it was on August 8th? Of course it is. But you yourself would agree with me that sometimes we all tend to make very sweeping statements or judgments or assessments. I think the picture is a little more complex, more granular than that. It's been less than 2 months since the Taliban took Afghanistan. And it's quite obvious also that things are far from settled, even in Kabul. I would urge some patience, some deliberation, and some caution. Now, I understand. I mean, that in this day and age, that's not how media can approach it, because you people have different compulsions, different timelines, and different pressures. So we will have this gap between you and me. You will keep provoking me with very strong statements saying, okay, react to that. I'm not ducking it. I'm just introducing an element of, practicality out there. And say, look, there are a lot of things, there are many things we know. There are many things we don't know. And I'll have to, and in some cases, we will wait for the situation to play out.
Shiv is hoping that you'll bat like Virendra Sehwag. You're offering a defense like Rahul Dravid instead.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's fine. Yeah. How do you see the Taliban takeover of Afghanistan impact our internal situation in Jammu and Kashmir? We've seen a ceasefire for the past several months, now being broken with terrorists being infiltrated into Jammu and Kashmir in higher numbers than recently. We've seen a spate of killings over the last few days. Are you concerned that the situation in Afghanistan complicates the already complicated situation in the valley?
You know, obviously, I would be concerned about what has been happening in the last few days, especially some of the targeted killings. But whether I would make that connection to what is happening with Afghanistan, I don't know. I would like to see evidence of some kind of connection there, if there is. Maybe there is, maybe there isn't. But I would obviously be concerned at some of the things which have happened in Srinagar.
In terms of the internal security itself, there are reports, not just Indian intel reports, but also the UN, reporting that Pak-based terror groups now joining hands and ranks with the Taliban is a concern. Is that a real concern for India?
Look, Geeta Dave, a very large number of Pak nationals, who you call them foreign fighters, call them terrorists, they were there. I mean, it's not something I need to say. There are UN reports which speak about them, okay? And speak about them in the thousands. Now, again, you don't need to believe me. Look at some of the debates which are taking place even in the United States, in the Congress, congressional hearings, questions being asked saying, what was the role of Pakistan at this point of time in that situation? And you've seen the responses from the American administration, which are very telling. So things are happening there. I mean, the role of Pakistan in what happened in Afghanistan is not a secret. I mean, it is very, very public. It is more public now because even they now speak about many of these things. So obviously that is a concern for the entire neighborhood, I mean, for the whole region.
Minister Jaishankar, staying with Pakistan for a moment, there's been a ceasefire, you know, between the two sides since February this year. The ceasefire violations themselves, as a result, have gone down, but there are still infiltrations happening. Dialogue hasn't been happening between the two sides for a while now. Could you give us a perspective of your vision of when you think things might sort of get back on track? We know about, you know, a probable back channel and things like that, but is it something that's foreseeable, sir? India and Pakistan talking to each other again?
By the way, I mean, the sense we don't talk is a bit exaggerated. They have an embassy. We have an embassy. I mean, our foreign ministry talks to the embassy, their foreign ministry talks to our embassy. So it's not like there is no communication. I mean, diplomats have continued to do what diplomats are supposed to do. I think the issue which you are, in a sense, pointing to was the fact that previously there was a beyond the routine diplomacy engagement on a, yes, on a certain set of issues. Now, this is not new. Some years ago, 2016 to be precise, the starting from Pathankot and then culminating at Uri, events went in a direction which made it very difficult to continue with that particular mode of engagement. And at the end of the day, there is a big question which all of us need to ask ourselves. When you say, when do you see that coming back? You tell me, when do you see Pakistan becoming a normal country? And for me, a normal country is a country which doesn't sponsor and execute terrorism against its neighbors, which trades with its neighbors on a MFN basis, which has connectivity with its neighbors, which allows people to move on the basis of visas. I mean, the way we do with all our other neighbors. I mean, if I look at a Bangladesh or a Nepal or a Sri Lanka or a Maldives, the question is, when do I have something similar with Pakistan? Now, right now, obviously, the prospects don't look good because the bottom line is that it is the not just the only one of our neighbors. You know, there are very, very few, I mean, to my mind, actually no other situation in the world today where a country actually runs this kind of you know, scale of terrorism against the neighborhood.
Minister, what's your reading of the state of play with China? We've seen a massive military buildup, which seems to continue, infrastructure projects, bringing in air assets, pumping up air defenses. We've tried to cope up as best as possible, given the asymmetry in our economic and military capabilities. However, things aren't quite as bad as they were immediately after Galwan, but they haven't completely come back to normal either. As External Affairs Minister, how do you read what's happening on the other side of the Himalayas?
Well, the way I read it is, that we, from the 1980s, I think developed a workable, decent relationship with the Chinese, predicated on the fact that there would be peace and tranquility in the border areas. This was not just an assumption or a conversation, it was written into agreements between us. Now, come 2020, we saw the Chinese side disregard those agreements for reasons which are still not clear to us, because I've met my counterpart a number of times, and others in our system have engaged each other. I've still not heard a credible explanation as to why they chose to bring that size of forces to that sector of our border. Now, if peace and tranquility is disturbed, then attempts are being made to change the LAC, the status quo, unilaterally, and large forces are brought to the border in contravention of written agreement, then obviously the relationship will be impacted. Now, if we need to get back to a normal relationship, which they say that they want, and which both of us believe is in our mutual interest, then I think they need to stick with the agreements and do the right things. Now, we've had, yes, some progress. We've had progress in Pangong So, we've had progress in a few other areas. But I think the larger problem remains, which is that there is a very sizable Chinese force very close, close if not at the LAC.
Dr. Jaishankar, it's not so much the achievements of Modi administration in international affairs, but it's the difficulties in relations that finds a lot of space in domestic politics. Now, we've seen Rahul Gandhi walk out of the Parliamentary Committee on Foreign Relations when it comes to discussions on China, demanding that there needs to be discussion. There has been a lot of talk from the opposition on whether if the government has been transparent enough. Just wanted to know whether if there is a sense in the government in briefing the opposition of the difficulties that the government faces or the difficulties that the government now faces with China, and whether if the government indeed has been transparent with the country and with the opposition.
Look, I've been in the government a long time, a really long time, and over multiple governments. I think governments, obviously, when it comes to national security situations, all governments, when it comes to national security situations, say enough so that people outside the government have a fair sense of what is happening, and expect that people outside there will be supportive of larger national objectives and goals. Now, if sometimes it doesn't happen because people are busy politicking, I just have to say it's a very sorry state of affairs. But I don't think, just look back at the last year and a half. We know so much about what is happening out there. So nobody can say, I have not been told enough, or there's been lack of briefing. I mean, I don't know the standing committee episode that you are referring to, but I can tell you, for example, as a foreign minister, we have a consultative committee, and we, this issue has been discussed. So it's been discussed in Parliament. Raksha Mantri has given repeated statements. So I think somewhere we need a sense of responsibility and maturity when it comes to national security matters. It should not be a subject for posturing.
Minister, staying with China, from the political part of it, just going back to the LAC for a moment, there have, as you no doubt know, there have been multiple rounds of talks, over a dozen rounds of talks between the core commanders. You've met your counterpart a few times. There's a question of the return to status quo of April 2020, and there is also a sense that the Chinese are there in large numbers, they're talking to us, but there's no sign of any really big disengagement. Have things changed on the ground, sir? is there a realization that this situation is becoming a kind of semi-permanent, foreseeable future kind of situation where we have to live with the Chinese in large numbers at our doorstep?
Have things changed on the ground with reference to April 2020?
Yes, yes.
Well, obviously. I mean, things have changed enormously on the ground. I mean, they brought forces up, so we have counter-deployed. So now if you ask me how long will that continue, it will continue as long as they deploy. So look, let me be very, very clear about one thing. Yes, I mean, they have done things, as I said, which were in contravention of agreements, etc. But there's been no lack of resolve or firmness or effectiveness in terms of what we have to do to protect our national security. So we've also had additional deployments, and they've stayed through one winter. We are getting close to another winter. So I have every confidence that the Indian Armed Forces will do what they have to do to protect this country. And I expect everybody else who's reasonably patriotic to have the same confidence.
Dr. Jaishankar, having one hostile neighbor is bad enough. At this moment, we have the PLA amassed along the LAC. We have the Pakistani army, which continues its nefarious designs along the line of control and in Jammu and Kashmir. And now we have in Afghanistan, China and Pakistan working in concert. Would you say in some senses this is a worst case strategic situation playing itself out? And how are you recalibrating India's strategy given the fact that you've got two hostile neighbors working so closely in tandem?
You know, Rahul, we're coming back to this point, which is you pose the problem as though I have a choice in the matter. I don't. You know, I have what I have. So if I, you know, I've had a pretty much a continuously difficult situation on my western border. Now, if along with that I have an aggravation on my northern border, but I will do what I have to do to meet it. No, I can't say, well, I'm overstretched or I don't like it or, you know, this is a very complex challenge. I mean, I'm presented with a clear and present danger, and I have to respond to that. And I would say, very frankly, we have, you know, the armed forces have done that, have done a very good job in responding to it.
You know, the one thing I'm sure many people sitting here at the India Today Conclave and watching on TV or on our digital assets would really appreciate is the manner in which not just that we stood up to the PLA, but we stood up to neo-imperialism of kind being shown by the United Kingdom on the issue of the Desi vaccine. The same vaccine, when they're administering to their citizens, to others, they think is good enough for them to be allowed to travel the world over, and when India administers the COVID shield, somehow they had a problem, and that's, you know, really a sign of a new assertive India saying, okay, you don't let me in, I don't let you in, now you're quarantined as well. Well done, Dr. Jaishankar.
Well, thank you. I just think it's a sensible India. I mean, what else would you do? I mean, to me, this was a problem which shouldn't have arisen in the first place. So, we did what we had to do, and I'm glad we've sorted out the situation. And I had a very, very cordial talk with my counterpart this afternoon. So I hope both of us agreed that we should find ways by which travel happens more freely and naturally and without quarantine between our countries. So that's where it is.
Just shifting focus to the United States of America, we're looking at an entirely new theater. That's the AUKUS. We know Prime Minister Narendra Modi went to the United States of America. The Quad Summit was a great success. But how do you see the Quad vis-a-vis AUKUS, which is a military alliance, and it is very openly says it's a counter-China alliance?
Well, look, I'm not part of AUKUS, so what AUKUS says doesn't say is for them to decide. My understanding of it is a large part of it derives from a particular capability, which is an Australian submarine capability, and whatever discussions the concerned countries have had about enhancing that capability. But very frankly, I don't see a particular connection between any of that and the Quad. I mean, first of all, two of us in the Quad, Japan and us, I'm not, you know, not involved in it. Secondly, a lot of Quad countries, two of them or one of them sometimes, have other relationships, other trilaterals or quadrilaterals or other organizations. So it's not that there's any understanding that the four Quad countries only deal among themselves. Everybody deals with everybody else. I mean, we ourselves have a trilateral, we and Australia with Indonesia. We have a trilateral, we and Australia with Japan. Interestingly, we and Australia have a trilateral with France, okay, which was supposed to meet in New York, which didn't. Today, the nature of diplomacy has changed. This combination of countries is sitting together and figuring out how best to advance their interests and address their concerns. This is getting more and more routinized. This is evolution of the international order, partly because we are moving away from the bipolar and the unipolar world. So even the United States, you know, finds it useful to work with other countries, and obviously other, you know, lesser powers even more so. The fact is also that the reality of the strategic landscape, multilateral solutions and initiatives are not readily available. So I think to some extent, you know, the UN is gridlocked, it is anachronistic, it's, you know, often not there. So when you have that situation, but the problems are still real and pressing, I think countries have just decided, okay, we'll go find our own fix. And this is one of those cases.
Minister, you've been at the very tops of India's official machinery, and now you're the minister. Very curious to know, and I'm sure a lot of other people are as well, if you could give us a little bit of insight into how the machine sort of recalibrated itself from a Trump administration to a Biden administration. We all know what the Trump administration was like. Yeah, I just want to know, you know, how is it dealing with Trump, and how different is it dealing with a President Biden?
No, our machine or their machine?
Our machine. Yes.
Okay. Look, you know.
And your ministry in particular.
Sure. Oh, that's the machine, yes. Which... it's the nature of our business to adjust to whatever is out there. Okay. I mean, so if you have a Trump administration, you obviously study the Trump administration, dissect it, figure out who are the players, what makes them move, you know, how do you make your pitch, what are their sensitivities. So it's, in a sense, a universal proposition. I mean, diplomacy is about studying foreign governments, countries, administrations, and figuring out how to get your work done. Now, I quite take your point that there's a contrast between Trump and Biden. You study it and decide how to adjust your working methods and your agenda and your articulation and, in a sense, your tactics.
Is it a fair assessment from the outside that the Modi government would have been more comfortable continuing to work with the Trump administration than it is working with the Democrat administration, which wherever it gets an opportunity likes to raise issues sometimes which the Indian government or the ruling party doesn't find very happy to have to engage with?
No, look, my first experience with Prime Minister Modi engaging the United States was not with Trump, it was with Obama. Okay. Now, I want you to go back when Trump won the election. And if you check back, many of you actually said it's going to be very difficult for Indians to deal with Trump. Okay. Then when the next guy wins the election, all of you say it's going to be very difficult for the Indians to deal with Biden. Now, I hate to disappoint you. We're going to be actually fairly good at dealing with whoever's out there. That's our job.
So we've all seen, yes, Minister, you're amongst those very few who's been on both sides of the table. give everyone sitting here some insights, and you can let your guard down and bat like Sehwag for a moment, between, on the difference between being, say, foreign secretary and foreign minister. A, I'm curious to know which one do you enjoy more, which is the trickier job, and which one, what kind of insights do you have?
Well, actually, you know, I've done three of those jobs, which is the minister hacker job, the Applebee job, but I've also done the Bernard job, which is being the special assistant to the minister. Now, if you refer to yes, minister, and then tell somebody, let your guard down, the Applebee in me comes out, you know. So, look, it's a different role, it's a different kind of, I would say, in a sense, a different mindset. I mean, to me, the big change was once you are political, once you're a minister, you are actually are less departmental. You have a much greater exposure to the bigger picture. I mean, for example, when you sit in cabinet meetings, you have a full 360 view of the government, all the departments, what are the concerns. So you tend to see your own responsibilities in that light. Whereas if you are a secretary of a department, however enlightened you are, at the end of the day, you are very much, I won't say a prisoner of your department, but a champion of your department. So it is a difference. It is an evolution in a way. Obviously, if I didn't like it, I wouldn't be doing it.
Which one did you enjoy more?
I always enjoy most what I'm doing currently.
See, that's the advantage of being a diplomat. Not one comma, full stop, out of place. You can't get him swishing outside the off stump and get him caught behind. That's not going to happen.
Just one question again on your personal experience. Is there anything as a diplomat that you would have changed in terms of your minister in the past, of decisions taken that you thought you could have done differently now that you're a minister?
I've never thought about it that way. But I do want to tell you that, you know, and I say this particularly of recent times, look, good ministries, good government in a way, runs very much on the basis of the minister and the secretary sort of working as a team. And when I was foreign secretary, I had Shashmaji as my minister, and we got along very, very well. I mean, you cover the beat, so you've actually seen it. Foreign policy being what it is also in all countries. You know, foreign policy today very much involves the head, the executive head of the government. So the prime minister in our country is also very deeply involved. And as we get bigger, more capable, more global, that is something which is natural. It's not unique to us. In every country, every society, that has happened. So I would say almost, you know, it's not like you do something as a secretary which you don't know as a minister, or it's a very, very collaborative kind of decision making by very nature. Or at least everything important tends to be, by definition, very, very collaborative. So maybe when I look back, not really. I think I'd be quite pleased with what we did.
A very collaborative partnership, but if I could ask you, Minister, were there any things that you didn't expect when you became a minister? Were there any surprises? Did you find that there were certain things that looked different when you were foreign secretary, but you had a completely different perspective about, in terms of the machinery, when you're minister?
Well, I mean, first of all, I didn't expect to become a minister. So, I mean, that was the first surprise when I did. Look, I had one great advantage. Okay, to be minister of a department which you have kind of grown up in is a huge advantage. And especially so in our case, because, the Foreign Service is a one ministry service. Okay, I mean, I've worked in some other places outside, but by and large. So you know your organization, very, very well. I mean, it's actually you've come up that organization. That's an enormous advantage. Now, the downside of that is you then also need to liberate yourself from the day-to-days of that organization. You know, you have to tell yourself when you're external affairs minister that you're not foreign secretary, that you don't, you detach yourself from a lot of that, which I think I've
tried. You had rewriting statements ever?
That's not a secretary or a ministerial.
I know, but when it comes to you, if you decide that you want to make some changes and be
it's,
a little...
It's always collaborative. So, but look, I the initial days took a, there is a transition, but I think I adjusted to it fairly quickly. And remember, a lot of my, I was discovering, learning new things as a political person. So I also, I couldn't be stuck in my old world. I mean, I had a new world I had entered, and I had a lot of learning out there. So a lot of my interest and energies went into that. So I think that's how I made the transition.
Just one, don't be guarded, just one honest answer on a mistake that you thought you made as a minister and, a learning of sorts.
Why don't you tell me? Because, honestly, as I said, look, the number of times you talk to each other, we are far more interactive than actually you people would imagine. So, if you're asking me whether decisions you made which you would have revisited, there could be, But they were not my decisions as a secretary or somebody else's decision as a minister. They were our decisions. And that's been very much, very much I would say, in a way, a hallmark of also the Modi government. I mean, it's a very, very, there's a lot of emphasis put on team effort, on, you use sports analogy, okay? It's a very team-driven way of working. Not just between minister and secretary, but even between ministers. I mean, I think what I see, how much time I spend with my ministerial colleagues working out larger foreign policy issues, say finance, trade, health, civil aviation. How much we go into each other's offices, talk to each other, WhatsApp each other. It's actually far more than my recollection of previous governments. But then bear in mind, I wasn't the minister. I was at that point, the civil servant.
One of the most important points Dr. Jaishankar makes in his book, The India Way, and I think that's something which all of us need to reflect on, is that growing up and in our readings, we spend so much time reflecting on what American thinkers and strategy war, or British thinkers, or German thinkers, maybe recently even Chinese thinkers have been writing, and there's so little reflection on Indian writings, Indian strategy, and you bring that out in your book, and I want to use this opportunity for you to reflect on that larger point, that a lot of our thinking on foreign affairs, strategy, war, typically comes out of the Western world, and not so much out of our reading of the Mahabharata, Ramayana, which you keep going back to in your book, and that's something which I found to be a real eye-opener, and I was wowed by how you brought it all together to present the India way as it is right now, and why is that so important to you, Dr. Jaishankar?
Well, it's something which, I wrote it in the book, but it's something which I had thought about for a long time, partly because for me, Mahabharata has always been probably the greatest sort of strategic book ever written. I mean, there isn't a situation in the world you encounter which doesn't have some kind of analogy out there. And it's something which, from probably my early teens, you've been absorbing it. But I wrote it at that point of time. In fact, interestingly, one person with whom I discussed a lot of that was Sushma Swaraj. And I wrote it at that time, partly because I felt that India has changed. If you look today, at our politics, at our personality, at the aspirations, at actually how much, in a sense, deeper, broader our system has struck roots. The widening of people, you know, where are people drawn from, who today are setting the debate, discussing the big issues of the day. I think we have become a much broader, much more diversified, much more truer reflection of our country. And such people, I felt, would readily relate to an argument which was long inside me, which is, look, please look at your own history, your own culture, your own tradition. There is so much out there. And if you draw on it, you will actually get, because remember, one of the most obvious sort of practices of my trade is to find that analogous situation. You know, if you tell someone so-and-so in a foreign country is just like so-and-so in India, they get it, okay? Immediately, the sort of, so.
What did you tell someone recently? So-and-so is who, and who is he similar to in India? Let's see what you do. Go for it.
It's X and Y, okay. So, but you know, that's what you do. And that exercise was part of that.
Minister, we're almost out of time, but I definitely wanted to ask you, this is a government that's reputed to be very high tempo, hardly takes any breaks, the Prime Minister as well. You are in one of the hottest seats in this government. Apart from reading and writing, I know you read a lot, I know you write a lot. Apart from that, do you get a lot of breaks? Do you take breaks? How do you unwind? We'd like to know.
Breaks, like, you mean off days?
Off days and to relax.
What are you talking about, Shiv? What's that?
No, look, I think today there's so many things happening in the country, around the world, that even if somebody gave you an off day, you wouldn't take it, you know, because you would have stuff to do, you'd be involved in it. So, I do all the things which normal people do, you know. I mean, I take a walk in the morning, I play some sports,
He beat you at squash, Shiv. He beat you at squash even now. Yeah. One last question, sir. We spoke of the India way, the Mahabharata, the Ramayana. I want to take you to Chinese military tricks and texts and strategy. And I'm very curious to know from you, because if you read Chinese texts and strategy, they talk of, the Warring Kingdoms talk of two scenarios. One is power that is rising, and I refer to modern-day China, which believes its time has come and therefore starts asserting itself over neighboring kingdoms. The other is the most fatal mistake a power can make. In its rise, it believes it's risen sooner than it actually has. That leads it to make fatal errors. And I draw you now to what's happening between China and, say, India along the LAC, which leads to counterbalancing between other kingdoms in the modern context, say India, America, Australia, Japan, coming together as a counterbalance force against the rising superpower. And I want you to look now into the future and tell us, 30, 40 years from now, would China have made the fatal mistake of the Warring Kingdoms of having believed that its time has come before it actually did?
You only know that answer 30, 40 years from now. No, first of all, I, as India, I have a bigger aspiration and, frankly, a bigger existence than be just counterbalanced to other people. Okay, I have my own interests and how I'm going to pursue it, and often that may lead me to make some decisions which would be in concert with others. In some cases, it may not be. So, implicit in your question was, you know, a kind of, are you part of a larger strategy of counterbalancing? I don't think that is the case. I think India, there is a rise of India. Okay, I still argue in the initial stages of a rise of India, but the rise of India may happen at a different speed, with a different dynamic, in a different nature, but I think 30, 40, 50 years from now, people will look back and say, okay, these guys also did something phenomenal in their rise. So I wouldn't reduce ourselves to that. in terms of, you know, what China does as a historical proposition, I don't think it's just a in the Chinese history. I mean, I think it's a, in fact, an example which is much more quoted is that of Germany. That, you know, could Germany, if you were to ask a hypothetical historical question, could Germany have Wilhelmine Germany handle the First World War very differently? That you actually had what was the strongest power of its times, you know, which went and united a whole lot of other countries by their behavior. So there are examples. There are also examples of countries who have been very successful in managing the rise. The United States is one. You know, the beauty of history is you pick the examples you want to do. So eventually political science determines which part of history you like. So I would be a little cautious on that score.
Very rarely do you have, as Foreign Affairs Minister, a practitioner with whom you can have a deep conversation about Chinese military text or the Warring Kingdoms or even German military history. And that is just fantastic, and that's, you know, really good for all of us as Indians to have, whether we agree or disagree with some of what you did, but to have someone as accomplished as you at the wheel of India's foreign affairs. This is the first time you've come in real life to an India Today conclave. You've shared some really sharp insights with what's going on in your mind and how you're calibrating India's foreign policy. And we deeply appreciate you having taken our time. Can we have a very warm round of applause for India's Foreign Affairs Minister, Dr. Subramaniam Jaishankar? It's been an absolute privilege and a pleasure listening to you over the last 45 minutes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Minister. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, do put your hands together. A warm applause as I call upon Mr. Nazeeb Arif, Executive Vice President, ITC, to come up on stage and present a very small token of our appreciation to the Minister. Ladies and gentlemen, do put your hands together.